The book is set in 1940. The loop is 1940. And obviously, it could have been any time. But all my pictures were from the 20th century. So it couldn't be too old, or it would be weird to have photographs of people from the 1700s, let's say. But also, I really wanted to have these kids be in some sort of mortal peril, not only from a supernatural sort of paranormal source, which is the Hollows, but from something real and grounded and, you know, historical. And it seemed, you know, World War II was just right there staring at me, being like, here's an era where a lot of people feared for their lives and had to hide, who they are and conceal their identities. And there was so much crossover thematically between who the peculiars are and how persecuted people in those times had to act and behave to save their own lives, that I thought, this is perfect. When I heard that Tim Burton was gonna make the film, I was like, what? This is insane! And I'm still like that. It's been like 2 years and I'm still like, what? Can this be real life? Like on a daily basis. I'm still pinching myself. I met Tim and I saw the sets he had created and the costumes he had made and the people he had cast, and I saw, you know, these scenes coming to life, and I really started to get it, and I really started to understand why he'd made certain rather major changes in the story to Emma's character, to a couple of the other characters, to, you know, and then the story sort of like, the first half of the movie is a lot like the first half of the book, and then the second half of the movie kind of goes off in this other direction that feels, it feels like a different story in the same world. It's still Miss Peregrine, it's still my world, but it's like, Tim was like, what if we went over here? And it works really well for a movie. It's not as hard to let go and trust when Tim Burton is the surgeon who's doing the operation, you know? That made it really easy for me. As someone who grew up loving Tim's movies and being a huge fan of, you know, what he's done for the last 25 years, it was so exciting to me and unbelievable that he was interested in the book and was taking this on as a project, that I was just like nothing but excited. And you can just trust, you know, okay, well, this genius who seems totally perfect for the material and the tone of this story is going to make it his own. I just can't wait to see what he creates. Emma is my favorite character because she's so proud and so interesting and multi-layered, and she's got so much to do. She's kind of like the you know, head, sort of like the lead kid of the peculiar children, and it was just really interesting to work with her character and think about what it means to be 100 years old but look and feel like a 16 or 17 year old, and to live in this place that in many ways is kind of like a miniature heaven. You know, it's summer every day and you get to hang out with these friends and have this cool world that's all your own, and you're protected from the horrors of the outside world, but it's also a prison. It's sort of a golden cage, and what that paradox meant. You know, are you in heaven or hell, or is it both? Ella's great. She's the embodiment of Emma. Even though her power is totally different, her character is the same. Her heart, the spirit of Emma, has not changed. And I think that Ella is a really great choice. She's such a natural talent, and she has such dignity and such a like a sharp way of speaking that it's great. I think it's a great story for kids because so many kids feel different and other and outcast. And I did a little bit when I was a kid too. I mean, I felt like a weirdo all the time, and I think a lot of kids do. And this is a story about how, you know, outcasts, people who feel like they are outcasts, can find a family and find a group. And that was really important for me as a kid was finding other people who I gelled with and became my sort of peculiar family. I think fans of the book are going to find a great and rich expression of all of the stuff that's in the book, but writ large on the big screen with detail that I never could have imagined as I was writing. It's like Tim took the ideas I had and just like made them bigger and made them like vibrant, full color. And it's like a world you can lose yourself in a different way than the book.
Hi, it's Valerie here with a little bit of love. Did you know the voice actors of Mickey Mouse and Minnie Mouse from the 1930s got married in real life? For this and more movie facts, click on more videos.